Next up is Patrick. So other than talking about Spring Boot, he will show you the art of squeezing a 45-minute presentation into 35 minutes. So 1.2 speed. Go, Patrick.
Thanks a lot. So very warm welcome to my talk, Lean Spring Boot Applications for the Cloud, because I'm on a journey to find out, like, how can I make my Spring Boot applications faster? I started this journey at the beginning of the year, and I found so many ways how to, like, optimize my Spring Boot applications I have in a Kubernetes cluster or in the cloud, and I will just, like, let you know, like, what I have found so far and obviously what you can add in the future. And just to say, you will see some numbers, actually, in my presentation. These are estimates or for educational purposes only. I'm saying this actually because I did some performance tests and also like benchmarks, like measuring the things. And I'm not doing like a product vendor, these benchmarks. I'm not showing you the best numbers. I'm showing you a reasonable number, which might be like very similar to what you might have in production. So like they are more like production like values. So that might mean sometimes the numbers are not like what I would 100% expect, but they would be like in a range where you could say it's acceptable or not. So it's me, it's Patrick. I'm a technical agile coach, software crafter, helping teams to get better. I do that in Switzerland. I'm also lecturing at the University of Applied Sciences in Switzerland, in Zurich. And I do many things besides just like being a consultant, being a lecturer, doing trainings, doing architecture, coaching teams, and so on. I also like organize conferences and other things as well. So my life is pretty much about learning. What is actually the problem? If you see Josh Long actually talking about Spring, you always have like a very simple Hello World example where they show like some features, how it works. And that's actually not my regular production application. So that's why I want to show you how this works, like in reality, what you can improve. Just it's way better than just the regular Hello World applications. And I'm a Spring guy since 2007. So I have done in my career a lot of Spring. So I have a lot of knowledge also there, and I try to squeeze everything into my presentation today. Yes. So let's dive into the topic. So the question is, when you are going to a cloud, people would ask you, like, how much CPU would you use? What amount of RAM do you need for your application? What amount of storage do you need? Which technology you should use? And basically, every one of us, I'm assuming, would say, I have no idea. And because we don't know, like, under which circumstances our application is running. And probably we are using the technology stack we are used to use, or the tool we know best, basically, to fix the problem. But like resources-wise, I have no idea. And there is actually like a problem when you are going to the cloud that in certain environments, CPU and RAM, for example, is not linear scalable, which means actually like if you need a little bit more RAM, you need to add more CPU automatically. So for example, AWS has services like this where you really just like a little bit more RAM, you need more CPU and you pay for it. And then another thing would be also like if you transport containers, you need network, you have bandwidth capacity used, and maybe you want to optimize that too. So the fat jar, for example, is not a good idea to have in a Docker container. So I'm going to talk about things like how to like let the application start up faster, how we can actually like optimize for resources, and actually how we deal with the, let's call it latency, or basically response time of my application. So we're going first to have a look at the Spring Pet Clinic and check for the baseline. And then afterwards, we look at different optimizations. As you can see, optimizing Java, optimizing Spring Boot, optimizing the application itself, choosing maybe different runtimes, things like that. And in the end, I want to show you something which is more like a good summary of like many things combined. And I can show you that, for example, you can save like half of the container image size, save like 30% of RAM and other things, and being like as competitive as the benchmark baseline. Right, that's the goal. So the Spring Pet Clinic is basically a little shop where you add some things like veterinarians, and and also their customers. And it behaves kind of like a simple CRUD application, which is used for many things. Well, it looks like this, so it's not something really special, but it uses some integration of data access and server-side rendering and things like this. There are many pet clinics out there. Choose one if you want. If you want to learn a new technology with the Spring Boot framework, you just pick one, and then you can see, for example, how they can integrate in Vadin, or, for example, use GraphQL instead of a relational database, whatever. Have a look at those. It's a great point, actually, to start with and to see like how you could integrate it. But I'm not using this one. I'm using the official pet clinic, which is based on Spring Boot, Spring MVC, obviously, Spring Data. It uses a database. In my case, I'm using H2 because it makes like the examples a little bit easier. If I can run the DB with the application, I'm having caching in there, and I use server-side rendering as well. Right. So not the other pet clinics, just like the default one you can download from the Spring Framework repository. So if you want to optimize, actually, then we have to consider our technology stack. And obviously, when you go into the cloud, you want to have Docker containers or OCI containers. And Spring actually gives you the version of the build packs. And that's actually a great thing. And then you see current version of Spring Boot, the last version as a baseline of the JDK. 17, and then we have to keep in mind also when I execute the application for the in-memory database, there will be also always DB migration script running. And the examinations are just build time, startup time, resource usage, container, image size, and basically throughput of the application. Right. Build packs, just to mention here, I love them. And build packs are actually a thing how you can build the perfect container without thinking about how to do it, because the tool does it for you. And it's basically also fixed by the community. And one of the things, just to highlight here, is actually a thing which is on the, let me see that, if this works here. Here on the top, where it calculates the JVM memory stuff. And as you can see here, all these XMX parameters are calculated by a tool, and if you change the constraints for the container, they will be freshly calculated. So lots of memory tuning is already done by the container when you run a Spring Boot application with a build pack. If you don't do that, if you still have your own Docker files, this is actually the thing you would have to come up with yourself. And this Java memory calculator is a tool which is dating back to Cloud Foundry, a very old cloud platform. And they have been using that there already since ages. And we now leverage this inside these build packs for Java applications by default. OK. So remember, if you just go out of this talk and you remember one thing, build packs are 1,000 times better than your regular Docker file, because it can do like things like rewiring layers. It's more secure. You don't have to think of doing the things right. You don't run with a privileged user. There are so many things why build packs is actually better, right? So have a look at this, because it's awesome. When you start doing some benchmarking, you will actually try to find out where your application loses the most time. And during my preparation of this talk, I came across this tool by Maciej. And Maciej has written a tool which is called Spring Boot Startup Report, which actually is just a dependency to add. And you would have a slash startup report where it generates for you the report of your starting Spring Boot application. So it uses the internals of the measurements, the metrics, which are provided by Spring anyway, and exposes those in a nice report. So you could see like which parts, which groups of the Spring beans took how long. And for me, actually, the most interesting part is actually like the flame graph you see at the bottom. And you would actually see like which areas would take how long. So I can just suggest you like have a look at this like once, because you will realize that, for example, your Hibernate takes quite a lot of time just to initialize during the startup of your Spring Boot application, right? So that was just like something I was surprised by when I used this tool. And it gives you just like a feeling like where your application spends the most time. So you would see actually with spring.data, you would actually see these are the slots where Spring Data gets initialized, and behind the scenes also Hibernate. Great. But this just as a side note. So let's have a look like how we are going to benchmark things. I want to have a look at the build time. I want to have a look at the container image size. I want to have a look at the startup time and the memory usage just right after the startup of your Spring Boot app. And then I put load on the application, where I use this WRK tool to put some four cores generating 200 connections, doing 2,000 requests a second against my Spring Boot application. I do a warm-up phase, and I do a measurement to see like how much throughput can I get. And also, one of the important constraints is it's probably something you rarely get in production, but I found out that's actually like the best thing I could have is like the four virtual cores for my application, because like that's the sweet spot where you get the fastest startup time. But I'm sure you won't get it if you deploy that into Kubernetes. Your SREs will tell you something like 250 millicores or maybe 500 millicores is the thing you get for your application, right? But the four would be the sweet spot, and I'll tell you why also later. So if you're going to like create this benchmark, you are using Java 17. I use SDKman to show you like which Java version I'm using. If you're creating the Spring Boot part, or basically the spec clinic, build it with the containers and run it afterwards, you can see the build below. And the one with the watch there is actually always showing the reference of exactly this tool afterwards. So we compare always against our baseline. It's taking 56 milliseconds. The image size is around 360 megabytes. We have a startup time there with 3.9 seconds. We have initial RAM usage of like 278 megabytes of RAM. We get out of the 2,000 requests like 195 requests through. After that, after whole testing, we have a RAM usage of 450 megabytes, and then you see basically like the response times with the percentiles afterwards. I just like added them to show you like 50% of all calls are within 6 milliseconds, and if you go up, you see like in 99.99%, your response time is like this 138 milliseconds. And we just use those numbers to compare our things afterwards. So the easiest thing you can do is actually like updating your Java. And I'm just building here with the JDK 21. And what you would assume is that like a new Java version has some improvements. And if you look at these things, like building with Java 21, seeing like startup time is very similar, image size is bigger, usage of the RAM is like quite comparable. What we see is in the end, like the response time is slightly bit better. But remember, this is like the zero version of Java 21. And during my measurements, I have seen in the past, every release of the JDK in the LTS version gets better and better over time. So this is just like, keep in mind, it will get better high likely over time. So you see a new version of Java actually already improves something. Okay, so maybe you want to like change the way your application behaves, and this tier that stop level one actually is changing the way the JIT compiler is used inside your application. So you can actually select with this tier that stop level one that you're going to use C1 instead of C2, which would be the default for my setting. And just like jumping back to C1 would basically drastically improve startup times. And just by adding this Java tool options, you see startup time got way better. But you see also at the end, throughput got worse, way worse. So you can optimize for startup if you need it. Might be great for functions, for example. Right. Other optimization possibilities are, for example, lazy spring beans. And with the lazy spring beans, you can make all spring beans lazy. So when they're used the first time, they get initialized. And that's a way how you could actually like improve startup time again, because the application is started earlier because it's not fully initialized. And if you do lazy spring beans and use spring data and hibernate behind the scenes, make sure you also change the lazy initialization of spring data, and therefore we have a way better startup time. Yes. And everything else actually should behave very, very similar. And as you can see, probably we have some outliers, or the measurement was not like exactly the same, but like we did the same test, and I would expect that the application behaves exactly the same as previously, just optimized for startup. Right. Good. Another thing, which is maybe a brave idea, is get rid of actuators. Actuators are a great thing because you get health endpoints, readiness, liveness probes, metrics exposed, and things like that. And if you don't need them, you save around 140 spring beans in the creation of the startup. And that means actually you save some time. And your image size would be smaller if you reduce that. I'm here just joking, just to show you there is nothing for free. And having no actuator means actually like it's faster, which makes actually sense, right? Great. Another idea, just from a Spring Boot perspective, is actually telling where the application properties or application YAML file is specified. And by specifying or fixing that position, you're actually preventing that Spring Boot is going to check like four different locations where these files could be. So by explicitly setting it via property, you're basically specifying the path, and the startup should be faster. I'm saying should be faster. Here is exactly an example where I would expect that the difference is not so much. And I'm not lying with my numbers. So I didn't cheat. I didn't adjust them that it looks better. We just could say they look very, very similar, right? So for startup purpose. The rest needs to be in the same ballpark as well, as you can see. Right. Great. There is maybe another thing Spring Boot does for you automatically, because JMX is already disabled. And even using build packs, you would have to explicitly expose these JMX ports so that it will work. So I'm just saying here, JMX is a thing which is by default disabled because Spring Boot uses production defaults, and it doesn't make sense in the cloud to have those JMX added. So don't worry about it. Build packs is taking care of you and Spring Boot as well. And this is the reason why I love Spring Boot and build packs, because yes, the JMX thing is maybe a thing you see when you start your Spring Boot application in IntelliJ, because IntelliJ uses JMX to get the metrics for the visualizations inside the IDE when you run the application, like for example some paths of Spring MVC and other things. Right. So there you might see that still using JMX, but they explicitly enable it. Another thing, which is maybe something to take home with you, is actually like dependency cleanup. And with the dependency cleanup, I came across a tool which is called DepClean Maven plugin. And the DepClean Maven plugin analyzes your source code, actually checks not only source code, but also bytecode, looks for reflection and other things to find out which dependencies are not needed. And it creates for you a report where you could see like direct use dependencies, transitive dependencies which are used, and also dependencies which are maybe not used, right? So in Spring Boot, you usually use starters, and starters are meant to start with, but not to finish with. So the thing there is actually like the Spring Boot team has a opinion on what you probably do with your application, and they just add dependency which might fit you or not. And this is a thing to see like what you don't need. So you can actually remove the dependencies and therefore optimize the startup time. Be aware that the dependency cleanup tool actually is not aware of some magical things, like for example, auto configuration in Spring Boot. If you have Spring Context Indexer, it doesn't know about Spring Components. It doesn't know about component scanning and entity scanning. So you have to be aware of this. So take it with a salt of grain. And check yourself what you really can remove. But in the end, as you can see here in my example, I can remove about 9 megabytes of dependencies for the Spring Pet Clinic in the end. Right. So we would optimize here on the image size. Another thing which is pretty new and which is actually quite interesting is actually a thing called AOT, ahead of time compilation. And the Spring AOT here, it's not in combination with native images yet. Here we just use AOT to generate some code, which basically like creates code which faster lets your Spring Boot application start. So that means basically bean definitions you would component scan are written in code if you use the process AOT goal. And also things like, for example, profiles are pre-evaluated or written down in code so that Spring Boot does not need reflection at all to do this. So that means it generates code for you so that it runs faster. And obviously, there will be a little bit more code. You see it with the image size, it gets a little bit bigger. But actually, startup time should, I say should, be a little bit faster. But my measurements don't show that so clearly, right? So yeah, but probably that's like within the range of measurements where we just can say the benefit is not so significant here, like with other examples we have seen. There is another thing, actually, which is rarely known and used. It's called J-Link. And J-Link actually helps you to create the runtime which is dedicated or specified for your application. So J-Link can actually use the module descriptors you're in, have inside your application and reduce the modules you don't need. So build packs have a flag you can add. And as you can see, you can shrink actually the image size quite a lot just by adding this environment variable to use the J-Link actually additionally. And that means in the end, we have smaller image size. And I think everyone should do that. And if you know it a little bit better, you can actually add the modules yourself because the Spring dependencies do not contain the module info at all. So therefore, you could actually use JDEPs to find out like which modules are used. And then you can add it themselves. And you can see even here, I got it down to 236 megabytes compared to the 249 before, right? So you can actually shrink your Spring Boot applications significantly. So you see, build packs, it's so easy, right? You might think of maybe another JVM you could use. There is like this OpenJ9, and I'm not going to rant about them because the numbers they still have on their website is from Java 8. So they're absolutely lying here with the numbers. It's not that good as it looks like. And that's like what you can see on my numbers. So you would see if I use now OpenJ9, we would have like a benefit because of the RAM usage, which they also claim they are like famous for, but everything else is actually worse. So you see a little bit better image size, but startup time is like almost double, and also throughput is not really better, but the RAM usage is way better. Basically here in the build pack section, I just updated the thing. So that means like I'm patching now the Spring Boot Maven plugin to use OpenJ9 to be part of the Docker container. Right. If you go and actually optimize it for Docker environments with this JXTune virtualized, you can get way better numbers than before. Here, you can see now it's 17 milliseconds. If I jump back here to this version, we have startup time, which is worse, I think. Yes, but that should be fine, right? So it should be a little bit better, actually. But yeah. I think there is something wrong with the previous slide. So it should also have like worse throughput. Probably I didn't update the numbers correctly. Another thing, another idea, when you are using OpenJ9, you might say, let's use GraalVM, and GraalVM without native image, GraalVM as a JVM runtime, and this one should have actually a better garbage collector and also like a JIT compiler in there, and that means like we just could switch actually basically the runtime to the GraalVM. The community edition is not that great. The build packs at the moment only support the community edition. They're working on this GraalVM 3 to be also part of the build packs that should be coming soon, right? So that's why numbers are not great because like what you get for free is usually not so super optimized. Now, my favorite thing is actually another builder. And just by exchanging the builder from the default plugin, which would be based on Ubuntu, now we change to something which uses an Alpine Linux underneath, and using Muzzle or glibc as well to use that as a part where is the JVM based on. And you may have seen that Bellsoft also provides Liberica, So that's their runtime they support. So basically, they also provide support for VMware. And for example, if you use IntelliJ, IntelliJ internally also uses Liberica runtime. And here I just changed the builder. So I have like a way smaller base image. It's like the muscle is, I think, 7 megabytes big. And then on top, you have the JVM in there, right? So this actually like shrinks down the image as well. And you see like comparable throughput here as well as before, but it's like way, way thinner. So that's actually a great thing. Obviously, I have to talk about GraalVM, which is actually blazing fast and where you get an executable. I'm sure you have seen that before, but also GraalVM native images in the community edition is a little bit, not so great, like as you can see with the throughputs for the regular JVM, so, but it's still good enough, but basically the startup time is blazing fast. And also image size would be a little bit smaller, right? Okay, there is actually another thing at the horizon, which is called Crack, which is about checkpoint and restart recovery in Java. So the idea with this, and this will be also part of the next Spring version and Spring Boot, is that you can basically create a snapshot of your JVM, which is running, and then you just like reload all these binary files into the JVM again, and you basically restart from the same point. I don't have like something with a build pack because it does not exist yet, and there is only like with Azul at the moment something you can use in production. There is actually a port for the Crack for the OpenJDK, but it looks like it will never make it into the OpenJDK. So maybe you are going to need something similar or like you use a specific JVM distribution. Right. And when I was trying this out, it was quite weird because I needed a real Linux. Everything else does not work because of some system restrictions. So that means like if you use WSL or a MacBook or so, it just won't work. You really need to use Linux. But other vendors, like for example IBM with OpenJ9 or Cimeru, they call it, they also have this kind of support. They just call it CRIU, and they do basically the same. So you can have these features already, and some cloud providers actually have built that in already as well. Obviously, there is another thing with Java 21, the virtual threads, and my colleague in the other session just talks about that. With the newest version of Spring Boot, that would be like the 3.2 version, there is this property you can set just like Spring Threads virtual enabled equals true, and you can use virtual threads automatically for your Spring Boot application. You don't have to do anything, just use that and your Tomcat or Jetty is using virtual threads. And you can see it gets better actually, right? It really gets better. Some things like RAM usage is still like because of the Java 21, but basically throughput because threads are cheaper are or is way better. Yes. So let's summarize the whole talk. I was rushing through. We have seen like many optimizations you can think of. And obviously, there are quite a lot of things you can still do. And I think actually that if you go into this area and try to explore things, you will realize that four cores are basically the best thing. So you could say if your application runs with four cores, the startup time is basically the best, and it doesn't get better if you add a fifth core. If you go down to two cores, it's just like double the time. If you have even less, it gets worse, right? So it's not really linear, but if you can afford the four cores for startup, it would be perfect, but yeah. In the cloud, everything costs more than before, so therefore you probably don't have this. But if you're interested, there is also a blog post by Dave Sayer, which is the physicist in the Spring team. And he has also written a blog post about that, where he explains like why the four cores are basically like the best. Right. Think of that if you're going to measure. You have seen my numbers. They just work with my computer, with my application. You have to do proper load testing and benchmarking yourself. Right. I have the luck that I have a water-cooled computer at home, so I don't get into thermal throttling. But if you do load testing on your notebook, your CPU will actually will be throttled automatically after a few minutes, I would say, when it gets hot. So if you do comparison, make sure you have water cooling, because then you can have like the same temperature over a longer time, right? Great. Consider also other runtimes, as we learned. So that means like different versions of the JDK, different vendors also have some enterprise features you can pay for. I know we don't like to pay for things, but maybe sometimes it might be worth it to have this. And be also aware that coming Spring and Spring Boot versions are optimizing even more. And that means, for example, the crack support will be like in Spring Boot 3.2. Native image support gets better. They just, like I recently read about Project Reactor, also like using now lightweight threads. And things actually get better over time. So they are fixing basically our toolchain to get faster. And obviously, there are like lots of other ideas. And with some, I have already played around. Some, I didn't do it yet. But for example, I thought maybe it's an idea to use an obfuscator to shrink down my Java classes. I find it quite difficult if you're using component scanning and entity scanning, because then actually you have to make a lot of exceptions and it just doesn't work. Then there is this class data sharing, which could be an option to basically like improve all the startup time. There is like auto configuration, but manually, not at enabled auto configuration. Just import them yourself. Using functional Boolean definition should be faster. Spring context indexer gets removed with the next version of Spring Boot, so that's not an option anymore. More JVM tuning, garbage collector tuning you can do. And there is another promising project which was started like a year ago, but now there are official GitHub repositories. It's called Project Laden. And Project Laden actually has also the target to improve startup times for regular Java applications drastically. So that would be also like something to consider. But at the moment, there is no code, nothing to try. I just have seen their slides and their benchmarks, and they say it's like, wow, I don't believe it yet, but yeah. So I want to try it myself as soon as it's there. So like to summarize everything, the few simple optimizations you could do, for example, dependency cleanup, other build pack, J-Link, Java memory calculator, Spring AOT, lazy Spring Beans, and also fixing Spring Boot config location. You put everything together, and then actually, you have these things also configured as properties, and then you see that you get basically better images. So image size gets lower, startup time gets way better, you see the initial RAM, you see the throughput, you see even better response time, and this is something which you can do very easily without a problem, right? So just like by adding a few things, you can make your application basically starting up in half of the time. You save about 30% of RAM, and your image size is also like way more than half of it. So yeah, that's from my side. I know you have seen quite a lot. It was basically a mashup of all the things I have learned like throughout the years. And if you have questions or if you have other ideas what I could add to this talk, please let me know. I will be around. I'm happy to talk to you.